So, in an interview, this person whom you see here, Horst S., and I anonymize him today because I received his diaries from the family, and there's a Shoah Foundation interview, but the family has not yet said yes that his notes will be presented in the public. I'm still waiting. So, in an interview as of 1995, Horst S. reveals to the interviewer of the Shoah Foundation that his name was very popular at this time. And when he entered school in Berlin, three or four boys with the same name immediately formed a Horst Club. The interviewee is laughing, smiles, and he speaks within a warm atmosphere. And I came to these diaries, which you see here, because since several years I'm working on Hachshara and non-Zionist immigration preparation in Nazi Germany. And I listened to all the Shoah Foundation interviews to which I could listen to, which means I cannot speak, unfortunately, every language, but I don't know. I forgot, honestly speaking, the number. But as you know, when you listen to these interviews in the and the interviewee presents family pictures from the past and today, and then all of a sudden he showed these diaries from 1939 until 1941. And of course, I, as a historian, I was very keen to receive these diaries. I was searching and searching for, I don't know, 1 or 2 years, and then finally I found his son, not his daughter, because she was married and changed her surname, but then I found the son, and he introduced me to the daughter, and now, 4 years ago, I received them. And I only read them this year. So, to introduce the person Horst S. to you, he was born in December 1922 in Berlin. And, as I mentioned, to learn much more about the individual, I listened to this interview. It's only, because you know these interviews are some, from time to time very long, 2 hours. He grew up in post-World War I war Germany in Klosterstraße, which is near Alexanderplatz in the center, in the eastern center of Berlin. And he was 5 or 6 when the Great Depression started. His family was supported by wealthy relatives, and his father, a former bank official, was unemployed. In these notebooks, or he, of course, he calls it diary, it's written, you see it later on maybe a little bit better. He remembers political actions and demonstrations, but emphasizes that he never was confronted with personal violence, even though he remembers the events on April 1, 1933, the business boycott against Jews. And as the anti-Jewish policy became more aggressive in 1938, to him and his family, and of course to many, many other German Jews too, it became clear that there would be no future anymore in Germany. Horst S. wrote about the year 1938 into his diary, but only in 1939, but I don't know when exactly he wrote it down. I'm sure after the war's end. I quote, "The year also marks the complete decline of German Jewry." Finally, in 1940, he entered the agricultural school, or in Germany, the Jüdisches Auswandererlehrgut Großbresen in Schlesia, which was in contrast to other sites for immigration preparation, in 1936 not established by Hecher Lutz or Zionist youth movements or Zionist movements, but by the Reichsrepräsentation of German Jews. Its officials aimed at German teenagers and young people who were in need to leave Germany, but to other countries than mandate Palestine. And for example, the young people were formed in groups, and the respective group was named after its leader. For example, here was one group. It was led by a man with the name Erwin. I forgot his surname now. And after Großbresen, it happened the same then to nearly 15 to 18 other places in Germany. In 1941, it was transformed into a forced labor camp. And then later in the forced labor camp, the former inhabitants of Großbresen, they made this journal for their former group leader. And Großbresen is also famous for its not only ideological, but also its practical director, Kurt Bondy. After the war's end, he was famous for example, studies and research on youth in prisons, in German prisons. Ah, and I forgot to show you this here. No, this is Horst S. in Großbresen. This is also a picture from the Shoah Foundation interview. So I go further here. Most probably in May 39, he started to keep the journals, the so-called Taschenkalender, as you see them here. I have to say, during this life-changing period, which was to him, of course, a period of transition, the memories and the content remain fragmentary, and in the first 2 years, he seems to be a teenage chronicler without any bigger emotions. This is very, very special because he only documents. The notes are rather a mirror of his individual world. They bear witness of a young man expelled from his home country who, in contrast to many other, fell not victim, and he emphasizes this, to discriminating events. But of course, he emphasizes this, and I, as a historian, we spoke about, Chaim, you mentioned this in the morning. This is the story I, as a historian, make of his story. Yes? In this interview with the Shoah Foundation, he stated, by the way, that at some point he stopped writing after 41 because there was not anymore a necessity. He only gives us a glimpse into this necessity and his thoughts about this, as he tells the interviewer that there has been so much negative propaganda about Jews, and he had the feeling to set something against this. And by the way, Horst S. does not regard himself as a survivor. He speaks about himself being a refugee from Nazi Germany, as he did not, and I quote, experience terrible sufferings. So why, in my eyes, are these, for example, these diaries also an important source for history or Holocaust history? So I give an example from my individual research. We heard a lot about why ego documents are so important today, but in my eyes, when I started to research on emigration preparation from Nazi Germany, of course, it's very, you know, all of you know it, it's very dominated by the Zionist or the youth movement approach. And for example, ego documents like this, they widen or challenge these narratives. This diary, as well as other diaries which I received, or individual letters, not only from the Yad Vashem archives, but from relatives which I received, they widen this approach. I mentioned this. His and other eager documents, but also oral history testimonies of survivors and emigrants as well, portray a vibrant and diverse picture of young life under Nazi rule. For example, in this case, Horst S. was interested in books. He read all the classics of German literature, was attached to classical music, and he started to teach himself the piano as long as it was possible, to visit the opera and theaters. He visited them, and he loved to talk about cultural topics as such, and he was bored by young girls because in his eyes they were so boring you could not discuss with them intellectual topics. Okay, it's a very individual point of view, but it was interesting, it's mentioned several times. And to him and to many others, Kristallnacht was a turning point. From this point on, it was clear that, I mentioned it, a future in Germany would be not existent anymore. And Kristallnacht, by the way, was, in his own words, the only, first and only violence that he experienced during his German childhood and teenage years. His notes also reveal that this decision to go, he calls it also to go on Hachshara, even though it was not a Hachshara, was one rather ambivalent, highly complex. In his case, he was, I'll leave it up. It was highly complex and highly complex decision, but exactly this decision and his personality development was rather flexible and fluid. This is what I learned from his diaries, at least in the forthcoming 2 years after 39. Maybe typical for teenage years, and of course it was he was forced to change his decisions and make new decisions because of the political events. Within his lived time, according to Guy Miron, Horst S. was forced to be flexible. He wanted to go, as I mentioned, first he said, I want to go to Palestine, even though I am in Großbresen. I want to leave this place, I want to enter a Hachshara. But then his plans changed, as he was not satisfied with group life. He, like many former residents, are critical of the rigorous performance tests. One could either endure the structured and ideology-charged life, or one had to leave the group. Many stress that they struggled with the sense of no longer being wanted. He also, in his diary, later on, after 41, and having to leave the homeland as refugees, and describe ambivalent feelings of uncertainty about the fate of loved ones, vague apprehensions about the East, and security about the future. In their late teens or early 20s, at the time parallel to this, they resided outside the cities in the countryside or on the outskirts of small villages and towns. They were free of parental authority and could structure their daily life within the rules set by the respective group leaders, albeit within the broader framework of the restrictive regulations of the respective group. So, as the plight of German Jews, I mentioned it before, after the pogroms in 38 onward, a large majority of German Jews attempted to emigrate. It became more and more difficult to obtain entrance visa, but Horst S. and his family, they In late summer 41, they finally received the permission to leave Germany before it was prohibited to leave Germany. So finally, before it was prohibited, the family was allowed to leave Germany. So, what I found really interesting, while I was reading the first two diaries of 39 and 1940. They are really, really different from that one in the middle of 1941. So, for example, here, this is from February 1940, you see, I mean, I think you cannot read it, but sometimes you have only a half a sentence. You see Kuhstall, he worked with the cows, and for example, he had to work as a heater in Großbresen and so on, but these are more very short informations, like what he did and what he, I don't know, here for example, in the evening, abends üben, he trained himself on the piano and so on. So with little words, he documents during this period of transition political events, for example, Germans in Norway, Germans in Crete, and so on, but no emotions and somehow apathetic. Of course, this is not unusual, because diaries must not necessarily include personal thoughts or observations about the events described. And from time to time, he mentions the music again and the German literature and so on, writes about him being witness of air raids in Großbresen, documenting war events in Berlin, family visits, and the boy, of course, finally leaving Großbresen. So Guy Miron stated with regards to diaries that due to their nature, these sources seem particularly well suited to an examination, and I quote him of course now, of waiting as part of the broader question of the German Jews live time in that area. But when I was reading this, I would like to add to this, to these diaries of Horst S., the importance of his, how do you say, I cannot, it's like this felt or emotional time. Because, okay, I'll go further. Because originally it was not my aim to analyze his emotions in that diary, but it was obvious that until his emigration into the States, almost no feelings, as I mentioned, but not later when he left Germany, that changes 100% and the writings get emotional. He speaks of being alone, feeling deep longings to his friend Manfred. Horst S. speaks about making a pleasure to others, to family members and so on, and the fact that he himself can experience deep inner joy. Yes, and then I read it again, the diary, and then I found that in 1939 and 1940, as I mentioned, there were so many descriptions of German literature and classical music, they were more a mirror of his inner moods and when you read the book titles and so on, but it's not his personal feelings. And in this literature and in this music, you see his inner moods, tensions, and also fears, maybe. Finally, a short time before his family immigrated to the US, he speaks of the excitement and the hell that broke out since they learned they received visa for the United States. Now, it changed. Here, and every single page is like this. More words, smaller letters, not enough space for everything he writes and the emotions. It seemed as everything broke out that was hidden the years before. And in October 17, he finally writes, "How will the future be? I have no fear."
1940.
What did I say?
1940 or
40? No, 41, of course, yes. Of course, we as historians, because I'm not on a Holocaust historians conference today, but of course historians of the Holocaust are interested in contemporary ego documents for the view of the survivor as participant observer from within the events. But sometimes, in my eyes, the shadow side can be that one gets lost for the whole life circle of the individual. His or her life before Hitler came to power, and of course, after the war's end. So listening in the Shoah Foundation interview to his later life, his professional and family life, it was very interesting how he himself draw a direct line between his childhood and teenage years in Germany. So, as this is as an example, he became married to a woman from Mexico. Later on, they were divorced, and he interconnected and compared discrimination of Mexican Americans in the States and the successive exclusion from public life of German Jewry. So he connected his own history or his own life story with that what happened in his eyes then in the United States. And then he started to lecture about this and stated that he always had a good contact to people or to the audience who suffered from discriminatory events, as he often spoke about his biography, being a refugee and being not wanted anymore in his home country. To come to full circle, he finds himself empathetic with minority groups and connects this to his own experiences in Nazi Germany. So what can we learn from this diary of this non-prominent figure of Horst S., who was not an intellectual individual like all these famous diaries by Primo Levi and Elie Wiesel and so on and so on. But of course, as I mentioned, for me, first of all, it was this widening of this historical narrative which can be proved or which can be showcased in this life story of this person. And still until today, in my eyes, this immigration preparation there is dominated by the Zionist or youth movement perspective or approach. And then I was wondering by reading that in the 1939 and 1940 there were almost no emotions, and then in 41 it broke everything out. It would be interesting to read diaries again. When are there emotions, and why are there emotions expressed in diaries? And what I found interesting, the fluidity of his personality and the changes over time is, of course, as I mentioned, it's typical for teenage years or for young years, but how he changed, what would his future plans be? And then finally, when he was living in the United States and Yom Kippur in 1941 came, he said, "I do not feel anything, I'm not interested in Yom Kippur anymore." And now, I don't know, we don't learn why it happened. Maybe it was only a daily mood, and but when I received the diaries by his sister, his daughter, she asked me, "Could you please explain to me what is Hashara and emigration preparation?" My father never mentioned that this was something typical Jewish, and then I explained a little bit in two sentences, and then she said, "Ah, he always spoke about the reason of being a school and not something special for Jews." So that's it for today, and thanks for the attention.